There they go, the parade to the barrier. Mechanical thoroughbreds, tuned to the highest pitch, ready to make history in the toughest, most devastating test ever devised for motors and men. A mammoth crowd is tense, awaiting the opening of the great spectacle of speed. Every eye is focused on that lineup of shining speedsters. Ah, they are underway, slowly and deliberately. The pace car leads the pack. The mighty motors snort and roar in protest at being held in leash. Some of the high-strung mounts balk and must be pushed, but gradually the stragglers come to life and move off, jockeying into their proper positions. Now the flying start. The pace car crowds on all speed to get out of the way. Roscoe Turner waves them on. The leaders stamp on the throttle. And with full-throated roars of joyous power, the race is on, with a checkered flag 500 miles ahead. Who will be the first at the turn? Ah, it's Kelly Petillo. Behind him, the other drivers are fighting for position, so closely packed that they can reach out and touch their neighbors. And this is at better than 100 miles an hour. Does that take skill? Does that take nerve? Boy, you're asking me. On into the backstretch. The spurt for leadership continues. There is more than just honor in leading this race. Lap prizes spur them on to gain and hold first position. There's Petillo leading the field at the end of the first lap. But there are 199 more laps to go. Anything can happen between now and the finish, and most anything will. Well, this is the Indianapolis, where you can always expect the unexpected. This year, the race is more tricky than ever before. Each car is limited to a 15-gallon gasoline tank, necessitating at least three fueling stops during the race. And each car, except the diesel-powered racers, is limited to a total supply of 45 gallons for the race. That means that even at this whirlwind speed, the cars must average better than 11 miles to the gallon of gas. Oil is limited too, and the builders of these speed bugs have had to design for economy as well as for flashing performance. Perhaps it may seem unfair to thus handicap these racing cars, and no doubt it is. But the lessons learned on this roaring road someday will be reflected in finer performance and greater economy in your car. Such is the price of progress. Have you ever wondered how it would feel to skim around this track at better than 100 miles an hour? Would you really like to know? Okay, here we go. And believe me, this is the fastest automobile ride most of you will ever get. And now down the straightaway. The tachometer needle swings around to indicate a speed of nearly 120 miles an hour. Now, into the turn. Steady, hang on hard. Of course, the scenery just jumps around. But remember, this isn't a boulevard. It's the old brick track of the Indianapolis Speedway. Of course, it's tough on cars and drivers. And just think what this pace demands from tires. What a pounding. Every jounce is a sledgehammer blow at this speed. Thousands of terrific blows to the mile, and 500 miles. On every turn, the track fights to rip the tires off the wheels, and there are 800 turns in this race. Race drivers will tell you that the Indianapolis 500-mile race imposes a strain on tires equal to 40,000 miles of passenger car driving. Yet, the tires must stand up. Must take the abuse and like it. And they do. They're Firestones. It's the exclusive Firestone gum dipping process, which saturates every fiber of every cord with live rubber, that enables these champion tires to stand the strain of this constant punishment. Gum dipping provides such perfect adhesion between the plies of high stretch cords, the body and the tread, that even the terrific heat and centrifugal stresses developed in traveling as fast as 150 miles an hour cannot break this bond. Now, perhaps you have a better understanding of why the kings of speed demand Firestones all around. Traveling this treacherous speedway, the driver must keep one eye on the track and one eye on his rivals. No chance to watch the tires. So these men, who know best what time